Now let's look at the client side. Look at the ease with which any arbitrary client on the network can access the server object. What a client would do is look up the service provider by contacting a bootstrap name server in the Java RMI system. And it does a lookup of the URL. And when it does this lookup, so this URL is published. Once it is published, then it can look up this URL. And when it does this lookup of this URL using the facility that's available in the Java RMI system, then a local access point for that object is created on the client side. And so now we've got the access to the object that is at the server through this local name account. And once I have that, then I can do invocations on the methods that is available in the server object by simply calling those methods. I can do a deposit, I can do a withdraw, I can do a balance check. All of this, they look like normal procedure calls so far as the client is concerned, but each of this is really a call that is going out to the server, wherever that server happens to be, and the Java runtime system knows how to locate that server in order to do this invocation. That's the power of the Java RMI. The client does not know and does not care the location of the server. And if there are failures in any of these function executions, then remote exceptions will be thrown by the server through the Java runtime system back to the client. Of course, with the networked nature of this client-server relationship, if a remote exception is thrown and the client sees that the invocation did not succeed, which is the reason the client saw an exception thrown, it may have no way of knowing at what point in the invocation the call actually failed. And this is one of the problems when you have services that you have to reach across the network and you have to handle the exception.